diagram. That is relatively long. So it's lasers, optics, and accelerator system in nuclear studies. And in 2004, and this group that basically demonstrated how to use the laser accelerator to accelerate the electron. And that was the record. And the matter of fact, in their paper was considered as one of the 10 breakthroughs in that year. And after that,
the
director of the program in 2007.
Okay, that the program
Now, because of his remarkable achievement, he has quite a number of awards. For instance, in 2009, he received the Bronze Award from the Department of Energy. In 2010, he received the John Dawson Award for Excellency in Atomic Physics Research from the American Physical Society. And just last year, he received another award, this time from IEEE in particle accelerator science and technology. And also, he is a fellow of APS and IEEE, as well as AAAS. So let's welcome.
Can you all hear me?
Yeah.
Camille, thank you for the kind introduction. It's to talk to you about work doing on trying to solve big problems with small accelerators. And I will focus mainly on sort of a roadmap that we have developed for collider development, but then also with a more recent focus on lots of applications. And there's several students in the audience here, I see at least five of them that work on these topics. So I will give them a shout out whenever I talk about the stuff that they're doing. So let me start with this picture here. This is the founder of our lab, and he's carrying this little device, little cyclotron. And over a period of a little bit more than 80 years, the device that he held in his hand went to a machine that is the size of a small European country, a 27-kilometer circumference machine. And this machine is capable of storing about 300 megajoule of energy. And just to put that into perspective, I know you're all physicists, but it's nice to see a couple examples of what that means. It's a high-speed train going at about 100 miles an hour, or an aircraft carrier going at 12 knots. And so these are incredible numbers when you think about it. So for us to even think about replacing this type of technology is almost crazy. So now, fortunately, before she became director, it's nice to see a transition theme with actually sane comments coming out. As the next director on the LHC and her hopes for international particle physics, she was invited to comment on it. And she talked about this question here. Some people think that future governments will be unwilling to fund larger and more expensive facilities. Do you think a collider bigger than the LHC will ever be built? And will it depend on the LHC finding something new? So her answer was, the outstanding questions in physics are important and complex and difficult, and require the deployment of all the approaches the discipline has developed, from high-energy colliders to precision experiments and cosmic surveys. High-energy accelerators have been our most powerful tools of exploration in particle physics, so we cannot abandon them. And then the emphasis is, of course, mine. What we have to do is push the research and development in accelerator technology so that we will be able to reach higher energy with compact accelerators. And so it's great to see the CERN director put her weight behind a field of discovery and new developments in technology, which is a field that I will share with you today. So let's look at today's technology, which is really the workhorse of a lot of accelerators. Here is a cavity, a superconducting RF cavity. And the way this is put together, basically you go to your physics books, you figure out what fields you need, you go to a CAD design or an electromagnetic code design, you design the structures, you build them, and then you test them and you put them in a machine. And if you do things right, they'll give you fields on the order of 10 to 40 megavolt per meter. And once you've built them, you can use them. On the other hand, we are working on technology that's vastly different from the point of view that every time we fire this accelerator, we actually produce a new structure. And the structure that I will describe relies on the use of very intense laser pulses that propagate through plasma. And so your key ingredients are the laser and the plasma, and they form an accelerator. And so our field is really comes down to controlling the laser and controlling the plasma to do what it needs to do, namely produce high quality electron beams. So the question that I want to work on a little bit during this talk is, can this technology be developed for an energy frontier machine? Can it actually produce enough beam to be meaningful to particle physics, perhaps to light sources, or medical or security applications? So the outline of my talk is I'll go through a little bit of the basic physics. Move this cursor out of the way. Then the road towards colliders, experiments with petawatt lasers, the Bella laser I will describe, generation of multi-GeV electron beams, staging of multiple accelerator modules, one behind the other, and then very important for colliders as well as other applications is high average power operation. It's not enough to produce one shot of an electron beam, but you need to do this at very high repetition rate for it to be useful to people. And then I'll talk briefly about near or nearer term applications, namely radiation and medical. So if you do fall asleep during my talk, just dream about surfing. Here is a boat. And the boat goes over this lake and displaces the water, and it provides this wave behind this boat here. And this guy is brave enough or crazy enough to surf on this thing and picks up momentum by surfing on this wave. So let's replace the surfer by electrons, the boat by a laser, and the water by a plasma. And what you're doing now is basically sending in an intense laser pulse with enough photon pressure or ponderomotive force to displace plasma electrons out of the way from an initial neutral soup of ions and electrons. So you're snowplowing the electrons out of the way. The ions are typically immobile on the time scale that this laser works on the plasma. Typical pulse durations are a few tens of femtoseconds, and so it's hard to move these ions. But then, of course, when the electrons get snowplowed out of the way, they'll get pulled back by the ions, and they'll form a clump of very high density negative charge here. And this wave repeats itself. So what you've done is you've charge separated the positive and the negative charges. And so you've set up an electric field. And that electric field propagates with a phase velocity, which is tied to the velocity of the group velocity of the laser pulse. So this is basically the recipe for an accelerator. The field, the maximum field that you could get, is typically determined by, from Gauss's law here, the density that you operate at. And so you would say, I'm going to run at very high density because then I can generate very large fields and therefore get very high energy electrons. The story is, of course, a little bit more tricky than that. So the second ingredient that you need is if you set up these fields and electrons are going to surf on these fields, how do you make sure that the surfers are coming in at the right phase? And so here's a wave, an ocean wave, And actually the white foam is water moving forward. This is just water moving up and down. And you can see that these guys know what they're doing. They're all phasing exactly right, as opposed to that unfortunate guy right there who's injected out of phase. And so the trick here is, how do you control trapping processes in plasmas in such a way that what comes out is actually not a spray of electrons, but actually a well-controlled electron beam? So that's, again, that's a challenge for our community. So digging in a little bit deeper, coming back to this idea of the laser pulse, which is shown here, expelling the plasma electrons, leaving an ion column behind here. If you start looking at the orbits of the electrons when they snowplow out, some of them, or most of them, I should say, go on an orbit that basically follows the skin of this ion bubble or blowout regime, we call it. But some of the electrons will get pulled in and get sucked into this accelerating field. And you can see there's a little wiggle here. This will be important in the applications, so please remember that. But these electrons are actually our surfers. So we are not injecting external electrons. We're pulling them out of the plasma. And so this whole device is essentially laser plasma, and then you do things in such a way that you trigger this trapping here. Now, there's another regime. I've mainly talked about this regime here, which we call the blowout regime or the nonlinear regime. The ponderomotive pressure or the intensity of the laser beam is very high. Leads to complete cavitation here, no electrons present. But another regime is what we call the linear or quasi-linear regime, where it's more like a harmonic oscillator that you're driving. And there's a very big difference here. Here, these are density regions. Low density of electrons, high density, low density. And you can see here that it's fairly symmetric. This is a regime where you could accelerate both electrons and positrons. You just change them by the required phase to either the electrons move in this bucket here or the positrons move in this bucket. And here, the zone where you could park positrons is incredibly narrow. And so this is not a desirable regime for development of a collider, because it's very hard to get accelerating fields for the positrons and at the same time focusing force. This layer where they could ride is very, very thin. So we do experiments in both regimes because we want to understand the physics of what goes on. Now, the next thing you need to do is to think about, I've excited fields and assume that I'm going to trap these electrons. To what energy can I bring these particles? And so we have concepts in the field that we call the 3Ds of laser plasma acceleration. These are the diffraction of the laser pulse, the dephasing of the particle with the wave, and then the depletion of the laser pulse energy as it goes through the wake. Because as this laser pulse goes through the plasma, it's basically giving up energy. And for those that are more on the atomic physics end of the spectrum, it's like this photon decays into another photon and a plasmon. And this photon is of lower energy than the initial photon. So you're redshifting your laser pulse, and eventually you run out of a good quality laser beam to continue to do this. Now, diffraction itself is something that you can overcome by building equivalent of an optical fiber for your device. And dephasing is something that you can control by a density or the length of your structure. And dephasing, you can think of these surfers sliding down the wave. And if the surfers continue to ride the wave, they'll go into a decelerating phase and they'll start losing energy. So really, to control all of this, to build things like this, you need tailored, well-controlled laser beams. And in our research, we work with laser pulses ranging from the terawatt to the petawatt. And when you work with these laser beams, you need to make sure that your spot size is good, your pulse shape is good, your stability is good. And then a lot of the work that we've been doing over the years is really the control of the plasma itself. And this is the control of the transverse profile to allow you to build these equivalent optical fibers, or the longitudinal profile to control trapping and other phenomena. So what does the basic laser plasma accelerator look like in its simplest form? It's essentially a high power laser beam that you focus onto a gas jet. And these gas jets here are typically hydrogen or helium or some mix thereof. And by playing around with the focus of this laser beam on this gas jet here, the front of the laser pulse will ionize it, produce a plasma, and then the bulk of the laser beam will set up these waves. So you have your laser beam comes in, your gas target turns it into a plasma, out comes a laser beam and an electron beam, and then you have various diagnostics, and one of them is an electron spectrometer. So what I'm showing you here is the angular spread of the electron beam versus the electron beam energy, and this was done after quite a number of years of figuring out how to do this with a 10 terawatt laser beam. And you can see here, this is about a 200 MeV electron beam coming out of a device like this. So this is the simplest one, but we've recently started to play around with manipulating this profile of the gas jet in such a way that you can trigger injection. So how does this work? So here is the longitudinal profile. This is the density, and this is the distance. And this is work that Kelly Swanson has been involved in. And I will show you a movie. Hopefully this movie will run. Of what happens when the laser pulse, as it glides up this density, it starts producing this wave here. And watch what happens when it hits this transition point. Boom, that's where the electrons get born. So what happens is essentially this wave is rolling, and it's like a wave on the ocean rolling over a rock. All of a sudden, this rock perturbs the motion of the water, and some of the spray will go forward. And that's what we're doing here in this movie here. And you can, again, see that wiggle of these electrons. So we built this in a very simple setup. And there's Kelly. And so the setup is a gas jet where you simply move a blade, a razor blade into, and you play with the angle of the laser, of the razor blade, because it turns out that that angle is important in controlling how this density looks like. But so what Kelly found was you play around with one location, and what you're producing is a density profile which has a little cutoff here. And so she quantified all of these parts in the density profile, and then did multiple different scans of the position of this blade and the angle of the gas jet. And what you're seeing here is essentially a phase map of this density that we take by sending another probe beam through this plasma, and we watch it on a wavefront sensor. And you see this shock front right there. So you can control the spatial profile of this little gas in such a way that it produces the right conditions for electron beam generation. And so what I'm showing you here is electron beam central energy versus blade coverage. And this is the spread here, the energy spread. And so you can see that by changing the blade coverage, you actually can change the energy of the electron beam rather nicely. And so this is an important finding. And this shows you the performance of the electron beam at a given angle of the blade as a function of shot number, and you see this nice straight line. So this is a reproducible electron beam. And so this is a very simple little compact injector, but it produces up to 300 MeV electron beams from a gas jet that's only a couple millimeters long. So that's sort of our injector we work on now. The second one is the diffraction mitigation. And you have two ways of doing that. You could either invest in a bigger laser in such a way that you can make a bigger spot. So the bigger laser is needed because you want to keep the intensity high. So you need to invest more energy if you start to make your spot bigger. But obviously, if your spot is bigger, the diffraction length or your rally range of your laser pulse will become larger. So you have a longer interaction region where the laser will be high intensity. The second, in our opinion, better way of doing it is you build the equivalent of an optical fiber. How do you build an optical fiber for beams that are of 10 to the 18 to 10 to the 19 watts per square centimeter? Obviously, you do not use your telecom fibers because those will be blown up the first shot. the glass will just evaporate under these intensities. So what you do is you actually tailor a plasma in such a way that the plasma density is lower on axis and higher off axis. The index of refraction of a plasma depends on 1 minus the plasma density over the critical density. And so this here, vacuum here has index of refraction 1. The index here at the walls is actually lower than here, because here you have lower plasma density, here you have higher plasma density. So this is the equivalent of an optical fiber. High index of refraction here, low index of refraction there. I'll show you first some technology that we adopted from Oxford University, from my collaborator at the time, Simon Hooker, and Tony Gonzalez was involved in this. This is a way of producing these discharge waveguides in a very simple way. Basically, you take sapphire plates and you cut grooves in it, semi-cylinders. You take 2 of them, you glue them together, you put 2 electrodes on it, you fill it with gas through these little slots, you fire the discharge, and the ohmic heating of the current flowing through here will make this center region hot. It expands, and you get this nice plasma density profile, this radially shaped plasma density profile. And we use this in a bunch of experiments. Before we had this technology, we did use, and this was a former student, Cameron Geddes, UC Berkeley student, who's now staff at the Bella Center, did this for his PhD work. We were the first group to use laser-produced plasma channels and got, for the first time, narrow energy spread beams back in 2004, and we got the cover of Nature for this work. Before 2004, all of the beams our community were producing were basically 100% energy spread. We had no control over these surfers. They came out with every energy imaginable, from high energy all the way down to low energy. So we learned how to tailor this. We followed it up with a bigger laser in 2006. This was with a 10 terawatt system. We built a 40 terawatt system. We switched technology from laser-produced channels to capillary discharge-produced channels, and we managed to get a GV beam out with just a few percent energy spread. So how did we do this? Well, one of the key pieces of physics is this here, and it comes back to all of this wave breaking. So if you think about this wave breaking and starting to spit out electrons that are starting to accelerate, when these electrons start accelerating, they're starting to suppress the field a bit, because the charge of these electrons with it is an associated electric field, and it suppresses the field coming from the plasma. We call this beam loading. So it suppresses injection of more electrons, and then you make your accelerator just long enough to ensure that by the time the electrons come out, you're at this minimum of the wave, at the maximum of the energy. And in this way, you can get all of these surfers to come out with the same energy. And this here, this length scale, is set by the control of the density. And it turns out that the energy gain that you get is determined by the intensity of your laser pulse and inversely proportional to the density. Now, if you remember, I said earlier on that the electric fields go like the square root of the density. And here I'm telling you that you should not go to higher density, that you should go to lower density. The fundamental reason is that the distance that the particle can experience the field is called the dephasing length, and the dephasing length scales like the density to the minus 3/2. The lower the density, the faster your group velocity goes. In other words, the faster the motorboat goes, and the more distance it will take for the particle to catch up with the motorboat, and therefore your field times your length becomes a bigger number. And it goes like 1 over the density. And this was borne out by all the experiments. This goes back to 2004. This is the plasma density. All of the experiments followed the scaling here of more energy went to basically inversely proportional with the density. So back in 2006, when we got our GV beam with 40 terawatt, we went back to the DOE and said we would like to have yet another bigger laser. And this is the Bella laser. So we had to motivate the Bella laser by thinking through what would a collider look like. You guys keep on asking for bigger lasers, and you're asking that funding from particle physics. What is in there for particle physics? So we put together this straw man design of what a collider would look like. And a collider would look like a daisy chaining of these little modules. These are the capillary discharges, one after another. And essentially, you would bring in a laser pulse into the first module, produce electron beam, then bring in a fresh laser pulse into the next module, and keep on doing this. And you do the same on the positron end. You produce an electron beam, convert it to electron-positron pairs, phase things right so that the positrons can write this wave. And you get your positron collider. And then you collide these two beams, you focus them at each other. So we laid this out, and then Carl Schroeder, who's here as well, did a lot of work on thinking through the issues of these colliders, and there's still many, many more issues than were written up in this paper. There's a bunch of other subsequent papers, and it's a very rich area of research right now. But we got the Bella laser. The other thing that we got the Bella laser for was a bunch of these questions. So there were reports in the National Academies of Sciences asking questions like, how do cosmic accelerators work, and what are they accelerating? So we need a better understanding of relativistic plasmas. Is a new theory of matter and light needed at the highest energies? We know that QED is well tested up to 10 to the fifth Gauss. How about beyond the critical field? Understanding the destiny of the universe, detector development, training, providing electron beams to people like Cambiu, who can calibrate his detectors. And then exploring extreme physics in the laboratory. Can we use lasers to build colliders of the future? And so this work here with Bella Center was mentioned in quite a few of the reports. And there is a new National Academy study going on right now, and hopefully we'll see the report soon, of the importance of lasers for the general field of high energy density science, extreme physics, et cetera. So what does the Bella laser look like? So this is a picture of the Bella laser. It's a commercial laser that runs at more than 40 joule in 32 femtoseconds. And it can do this, and this is what sets it apart from many other systems, at 1 hertz. So we can fire these pulses at 1 hertz. So you could say, well, this is still a pitiful average power laser. It's only a 40 watt laser system. But it is still the world's highest repetition rate petawatt class system. So now you could also argue with me, well, this looks like a pretty darn big laser. And that's a criticism that we often get. But just to make sure you understand what it would take to do a conventional accelerator reaching 10 billion volt, have the length of about 5 football fields. This is what Bella looks like. This is the accelerator on Bella. And this is what Bella looks like on the scale of these football fields. So this is why we're doing this, because we believe that this technology here can be shrunk to such a size that it can actually develop real machines. So we started experiments on these machines, where we took the laser beam coming out of Bella, and we focused it on targets. And the targets are either these capillary discharges, or what Danny Mittelberger, and he's also here, has been working on, is gas jet experiments. So the laser beam gets focused with a very long focal length optic, 14 meters, onto these devices that typically have an opening of about a half a millimeter to maybe a millimeter, and they're 14 meters away. So you have to aim it very precisely, otherwise your structures will get damaged, obviously. After the interaction, you get basically rid of the laser beam in this device here, but you sample the laser beam onto a bunch of diagnostics, and these are the eyes and ears of the experiment. And then you analyze the electron beam through phosphor screens, charge monitors, and then a big magnetic spectrometer. So these capillary discharges were built. This is a 9 centimeter long version that runs at up to a kilohertz. You can see the plasma in here. These curved things here are a fill tube that connects to this line here. And then this curved line is for gas sensing. In between these two fill tubes, you have a static pressure. You have a static plasma density. So the beam comes in. You produce your plasma. This is what the laser mode looks like without the capillary. This is what it looks like with the capillary. And so this thing guides. And then after quite a bit of work, we managed to get beams with 16 joules of the Bella laser of up to 4.3 GeV. And this caused quite a splash in the community. But as I point out here, it only used 1/3 of the Bella peak power. So it brings up the question, well, are you just exaggerating the performance of the laser pulse, or is there some other physics going on? So this is, again, electron beam energy versus plasma density. These are the results that I showed in this plot over here. There's a group at Austin, a group in Korea, and us here. And this is the 1 over n density line. So we want to be over here. So it's not the laser power that was the problem, but it's the plasma density that was the problem. So why is the plasma density challenging? Why is it challenging to go to lower density? Not because of the discharge, but for the following reason. If you look at a laser pulse that you send through an optical fiber, and you have a spot size that you inject into your optical fiber that's equal to what we call the matched spot size, this laser beam will propagate through your system with the same size independent of propagation distance. But if you put a laser pulse in that is not quite matched, this laser pulse will oscillate around. So the plasma density controls this profile of the channel, and the spot size that you inject is controlled by the focal length of your final focusing optic. The plasma density affects a lot of things: the group velocity of the laser pulse, the wake amplitude, the injection thresholds, the defacing length, and the energy gain. And your channel steepness affects the propagation of this. So it turns out that our hands were a little bit tied behind our back on the choice of plasma density. Why? Because the laser beam at focus looks beautiful. This is the focus of the laser beam from Bella at focus. But the near field profile, the profile that comes out of your amplifier, forget this hole. This is a mirror with a hole where the electron beam goes through. Normally it's nice and flat. This is what we call a super Gaussian. So it contains higher order modes. So the confinement of these higher order modes is the challenge. And so the challenge was, if you inject the Gaussian beam into our capillary discharges, our simulations indicate you should confine all of the laser beam. This is the border, this is the sapphire. But for a measured profile at the density 4×10⁻¹⁷ per cubic centimeter, we lose control of the laser beam. And remember that 1% of 310 terawatt is 3 terawatt. And that's a lot of peak power going through these walls. So we had to run at higher density, 7×10⁻¹⁷, to provide confinement of this laser beam. But if you go to high density, you're walking back on this plot of 1 over n. And so we couldn't go beyond the 4.3 GeV at the time, because this is what happens to the channel. You can see all the damage here. So this was a big issue. And so we have now implemented a new system. And this is work by another one of my students, Joost Daniels. He's not a UC Berkeley student. All the others are UC Berkeley students, from the Technical University of Eindhoven. We're injecting another laser beam that precedes the short pulse laser beam. And that laser beam is a long laser pulse. So what does it do? When that laser pulse goes into the plasma channel, the electric field of the laser beam is starting to wiggle those electrons, those plasma electrons. And it wiggles them for enough time so that these electrons can collide with ions, and you have a three-body energy exchange. You have your electron, your ion, your photon. So your plasma electrons can start absorbing energy from the laser pulse, and they get hot. And as they get hot, they produce, in this density profile, this is radius of the capillary versus density, they produce these divots here, where the density has dropped, although the wall density is still high. So now you park your short pulse into this low density region, You confine it by the high density of the walls, and you provide the right density for it to reach high electron beam energies. So we've built this, and we're testing this right now on these structures. It's starting to work really nicely. And Carlo Benedetti did simulations on this. So what we expect to see is a little, tiny little electron beam here. After 45 centimeters, you'll see it. It goes up to 9 GeV. So structures about this long to produce a 9 GeV electron beam. So this is the laser beam, the wake, and this is the little electron beam. So we're building longer structures. This is a first attempt at a 27 centimeter long capillary discharge. But Kelly just recently implemented a longer stage, and we're going to start machining longer capillaries to get to this high energy. The next topic is on this question of depletion. Imagine now that you have your first module working. How do you hand off beam into a next module, and you power that module with an independent laser pulse? This was something that when we first proposed it 10 years ago, a lot of people in the field said, impossible, you're never going to succeed. You're never going to be able to align these laser beams. You're never going to be able to time them in such a way that this thing works. Of course, that didn't stop us. So you have now your two modules. And the first question you ask yourself is, how far apart should these modules be? The first module is powered by a laser pulse that comes off in this first experiment of a mirror with a 2 meter focal length, 2 meter focal length, powers this structure, which is only a couple centimeters long. And so you could say that's simple. I'm going to put the next mirror here with a hole, and I'm going to wait 2 meters to put the next module, because otherwise this mirror will get blown up if I put it too close. But clearly then you're starting to build long systems again with many meters of gap in between. So we decided, what's the fundamental issue? The fundamental issue is that the damage tolerance on this substrate that you put into in between stages is typically at the order of 10 to the 13 watts per square centimeter, unless you buy a very cheap optic that you can blow up every shot. So what is this? It's called a plasma mirror. And it's basically a VHS tape. And so that's what we started to use. And I'll show you what it looks like. So Carl worked out for your collider, this is the length of the collider in kilometers. This is the plasma density that you choose. And this is for different distances in between modules. And so it does matter. You go from 200 meter up to 400 meter in just 5 meter interstage distance. And imagine you would have to wait 10, 20 meters in between stages. This would be ridiculous, because all of a sudden, your whole average gradient goes back down. So the technology to do this is very, very important. So we set out this experiment. And we decided to do a first laser pulse, powers this first stage. Second laser pulse comes off a plasma mirror, couples into the second stage. And the second stage, you run into this quasi-linear regime, so that the only electron beam that gets produced comes from the first stage. Otherwise, every stage would produce a new electron beam. That's not what you want. So we realized while doing this experiment that this first notion of how the experiment would look like was a little bit too simple. So we had to invoke or use another element, which I briefly want to describe here. This is called, again, a capillary discharge. But this time, instead of manipulating the laser, it manipulates the electron beam. How does this do this? It's basically Biot-Savart's law. You have a current flowing through your plasma. Associated with that current is an azimuthal field. And that azimuthal field, if you do the polarity correct, will exert a force on your electron beam to focus it. And this is the same capillary discharges with zero current or with a judiciously chosen current to focus this electron beam. And so this is not a new idea. This was done in the 1950s and is used for ion beams. But this was the first time it was used for electron beams in our settings, and this was published by Jeroen van Tilburg and others in PRL. It's a beautiful lens because it's symmetric focusing, up to 3,000 tesla per meter, very low chromatic aberrations. The price you pay is your lens diameter is only a few hundred micron. So your electron beam better fit in that few hundred micron hole. So we built this device, a first injector, then the plasma lens, then the plasma mirror tape, the VHS tape, then a second stage, and we handed off beam from here through the lens, focused it on this stage, and then monitored it on the magnetic spectrometer. And now you play with the arrival time of the second laser beam with respect to the arrival time of the electron beam. So you can put the laser beam behind, won't have any effect on the electron beam, or you put it in front, and then these electrons will surf on the wake produced by the second laser pulse. What does it look like in real life? Like this. Here's the jet, capillary discharge, VHS tape, next stage, and this whole thing is only about 8.5 centimeters long. It's a very tiny little setup. So we worked a lot on the injector. This was before Kelly did the work with the gas blade, also high-end psi, a postdoc. So this was a little bit more energy spread than we really wanted. This was the injector. This was the plasma lens, bringing the beam instead of a big beam that enters the second stage down to a small beam. And then we basically played with the arrival time of this laser beam with respect to the arrival time of the electron beam. And this is the reference spectrum. Here, the electrons were riding in an accelerating phase, decelerating phase. What I'm showing you here is energy of the electron beam versus opening angle. And you can see the same wiggles here. And these are, each one of them is basically a bucket, accelerating bucket behind the laser beam. And to give you a sense of scale, this is basically 600 femtoseconds. So you basically dial a micrometer and you move these two pulses with respect to each other. So this was the first demonstration of staging, was published in Nature last year. So now we've asked for an upgrade of our Bella system to build another beamline and to basically do this at the 5GeV level. So we're in the process of building another longer structure, capillary lenses, plasma mirrors, and another capillary discharge. The first stage will bring the beam in about 25 centimeters up to 5GeV. Then we focus this beam with the plasma lens back onto the next stage. And this is all done in a distance of about 40 centimeters. This is a 5GeV beam. With conventional magnets, you would take many, many meters to do this. And then we power the second structure and we bring up the bunch energy up to about 10GeV. What also is important in this experiment is that we expect a very high trapping fraction. So most of the beam coming out of stage one to correctly focus onto stage two and be accelerated by stage two. So this is a crucial experiment for a future collider. So we have developed within the community essentially a roadmap for this path towards a collider. So we're in this continuing invention and discovery phase. So we're working on 10GeV module, on 5GeV plus 5GeV staging, on phase space shaping, efficiency, diagnostic tolerances, final focusing questions, etc. But you can see this is long haul. Lots of PhD theses in between. We're also pushing applications, and I'll say a few words about applications in a second. And then we're pushing laser technology, which right now is at the 40 watt level, but for the applications, we want 3 kilowatt, 30 kilowatt, and even 300 kilowatt average power lasers. So this is all written up, if you're interested, in a DOE document on advanced accelerated development strategy, this whole roadmap here. So I'm not going to go through all the numbers, but this is an example of a study that Carl did. And I want to point your attention to this. So the laser energy in this design for a collider that should reach a TV is about a 4.5 joule laser pulse. So 1/10 of the energy of Bella, a little bit longer laser pulse duration. But the crux is here. It needs to run, instead of at 1 hertz, at 45 kilohertz. So that this laser can power one stage and produce enough beam per second so that a PhD dissertation in particle physics doesn't take 30 years, that it's done on a reasonable time, that you have enough luminosity. And on top of it, you need to do this at very high efficiency. Because if you need a 300 kilowatt system, and you need 100 of them, that's 30 megawatts, and if they run at 1% efficiency, you're talking about a 3 gigawatt power plant next to your collider, which wouldn't be acceptable for society. So we've thought about that, of course, and we've launched a workshop back in 2013, thinking through how can we build lasers that currently run at 40 watts to the multi-kilowatt or tens of kilowatt with wall plug efficiency, with very high quality laser beams. So you take a page from what's happening in the fiber world. So in the fiber world, you can now buy commercially a 100 kilowatt CW fiber system. These are used for drilling. They go miles underground on optical fibers to soften up rock, and it has reduced the mechanical energy of drills by more than 90% by using lasers like this. They're built very modular, and so we would love to have lasers like this. But these are CW systems. These are not ultra-fast systems. They rely on incoherent combining of all of these pulses from each one of these little channels here, but to reach these phenomenal average powers. So as a first cut at doing something along those lines, we're thinking now with University of Rochester and MIT Lincoln Lab about upgrading Bella, or something like Bella, and combining it with industrial-style lasers with very high wall plug efficiency. And this was an idea from Peter Moulton to use an array of frequency-doubled pulsed ytterbium fiber lasers and replace all of these flash lamp pump systems at least by wall plug efficient fiber lasers as a next step. So it combines what we know very well about titanium sapphire, which is very good technology for short pulses, and it combines these high average power, high wall plug efficiency fiber systems. So that's one approach. The second approach, and Dar Dahlan was also working on this, is much more advanced in a way. It's an idea that says, okay, if I need wall plug efficiency, I go to diode pumped fiber technology. But fibers can only carry a very small amount of energy per fiber. So there were ideas a number of years ago to say, okay, I'll take 1 million fibers and I'll just phase them all, and some you magically do all of this. And then new ideas came out that says, no, let's be a little smarter about this. What are the things that you can control to generate a high energy laser pulse? It's essentially space, many channels. It's time, fold laser pulses on top of each other, and it's color, spectral, to synthesize with multiple colors one laser pulse. So this is the idea that you start with a pulse train, and you split that up in multiple colors, and each one goes through an amplifier, and you can see more multiplexing going on. Then you spatially combine these beams into a single beam, and then this pulse train gets basically folded on top of each other through coherent pulse stacking of all these little pulses. And Dar worked on the spatial combining and also some on the temporal combining. So the idea of the temporal combining came out of our Michigan partner, Almantas Galvanauskas, and he had a long plane ride, and he had enough time to do this animation here. So what it is essentially a cascade of little interferometers. So if you imagine this interferometer here, and I inject the first laser pulse, and this is a beam splitter. Part of the laser pulse energy will go this way, part of the laser pulse energy will go that way. Now this pulse comes around, and you make sure that the next pulse that comes in has the right amplitude and phase to coherently interfere with the guy that's coming down here in such a way that you minimize the amount of light going out of the cavity, and that you maximize the light going into the cavity. And at the very end, you use a pulse to sweep out every one of these cavities. And that's what the animation looks like. So the first pulse, obviously you can't do much about it. It's starting to fill these little cavities. And one downside is you see a little bit of energy there, a little bit there. These are called prepulses. But now they're starting to flatten out. These are all flat. And in the meantime, you keep on filling these cavities with very specially tailored pulses. And you'll see that the last pulse essentially empties out the entire cavity. So you have no active switching elements inside your cavity to generate this laser pulse. But you have to coherently control all the path lengths and all the phases. And this was exactly done. So we built cavities at Berkeley. We worked on the design of these cavities. So it's I'm not going to go through every detail of it. But here you see the result. Oops. OK, I'm going to delete this. OK. What would be behind this picture here is essentially 81 pulses with the output, 81 red little pulses with the output this guy. And this is the experiment, 81 input pulses with one pulse coming out. There's a little bit of prepulses you can tell here. So it's not perfect yet, but this was 81 pulses stacked on top of each other. And this shows you the stability of this whole mechanism. So this is very exciting, because this starts opening up laser technology to much higher average power. So I'd like to spend a couple minutes, and then I'm done, on applications. So we had a workshop about all of this collider stuff a year ago. And Michael Peskin, a particle theorist from SLAC, came out, gave a beautiful talk on what these machines should do. But we took this away from him. He said the era is in view where new accelerator technologies must take over from the current ones. This makes it very important to take the first steps toward practical plasma accelerators, proving their robustness for few GV electron accelerated applications such as FELs. This is only the beginning of a long road, but that road leads to the future of particle physics. So he's telling us, and of course we know this, go through a few applications, demonstrate that your stuff that works in your lab is actually beneficial to people in the light source community, in the medical community, or whatever. And so you can think of your roadmap then of colliders over here. This is beam energy versus beam power. Colliders are the most demanding. But you have all these other applications that you can start thinking about. Light sources, medical applications, security applications. And so we've been working on this in such a way that we build small accelerators where the machine can be brought to the problem, rather than the problem having to go to the machine. So there's multiple of these applications, collider, FEL, Betatron X-rays, which is a cheap synchrotron applications, attosecond light pulses, security applications that rely on the production of MEV Thomson gamma sources, medical applications where the accelerator becomes so small that it actually can enter the human body to treat the tumor right in situ. So we have a project on an FEL, and Fumika is here. Fumika is working on this project with Jeroen van Tilburg and Carl Schroeder to demonstrate that we can build a free electron laser, a compact free electron laser that relies on our capillary discharges, our plasma lenses, a chicane to manipulate the electron beam, and then an undulator, which we already obtained, to demonstrate FEL lasing at initially at sort of the 100 nanometer wavelength, but ultimately at maybe the few tens of nanometer wavelength. And this was funded by the Gordon and Betty Moore Foundation, as well as by Basic Energy Science. And as last application, I'd like to show this. This is this idea of putting an electron accelerator at the tip of an optical fiber. This 5 years ago, we came up with this idea. We filed a patent on it. It looked crazy. But now I'd like to point to this here. This was a recent result from Jérôme Faure, a former postdoc of mine, produced 5 MeV electrons with only 2 millijoule in a essentially single cycle laser pulse. So 2 millijoule in 3.4 femtoseconds. So it's just below a terawatt. And optical fibers special optical fibers like this Kagome fiber here can actually propagate levels of power like this, what we need. And so we're developing with Han Mao, he's a postdoc, special gas jets at the tip of the optical fiber so we can bring together all of this technology that we have developed onto a little device that could either go inside the body or inside a container to backlight a container with multi-MeV electrons and get gamma rays out. And so this is really sort of the ultimate in compactness of a tiny little particle accelerator. So we're very excited about this. So let me end up with this picture again, where we started. And just to be controversial, those that say cannot be done should not interrupt those that are doing it, which is a quote from George Bernard Shaw. Thank you for your attention. And so some of the students are here in the audience. These are all UC Berkeley students, postdocs, the staff here, and then the technical support, and then our collaborators.
Some questions?
There's a whole community using lasers to accelerate ions. And you do that from so we actually are doing experiments with Bella to produce the first ion beams with Bella. More than 15 years ago, they produced ion beams with lasers.
So we are now, like I said, weeks away from trying to do the same with Bella. Use ion beams, carbon or hydrogen, at a few tens of MeV coming out of solid charge.
Okay. Yeah.
You mean in the staging experiment? So there you make sure that the beam, the laser beam that powers the second structure arrives at the right time for electrons to get into that bucket,
and then they will wind
with that laser beam in that second bucket. It's all phase,
it's
to ensure, and then the micron precision to align the beams spatially on top of each other and temporally. But femtosecond synchronization, if you split off from the same laser pulse, it's a matter of control of path length and micrometer.
Okay.
Yeah, so what Roger is referring to is there's a major experiments going on at Stanford where instead of a laser pulse, they use relativistic electron beams. And they use electron beams, initially it was at the 50 GeV level. Since then, the slack linac has been chopped up in pieces. So now it's down to, in the latest incarnation, it'll be at about the 10 GeV level. Because it's driven by a conventional linac, the 10 GeV slack structure is still a very long machine. The advantages that it has is that that particle beam already goes at a very high velocity. So the dephasing issues are not the same as what we have for the laser. We're tied to the group velocity. But the fact is you have to have a large conventional accelerator to power this system here. So the ideas there are, once you have your conventional accelerator, to maybe energy double a bunch with a conventional accelerator and park a beam on the wake excited by the conventional first electron beam. And so this is certainly a concept. I think in terms of applications, the compactness and the versatility of the lasers, I cannot imagine putting a large conventional linac on a truck to produce another electron beam, but I can imagine doing it with a laser beam.
But in the high energy physics world,
It all depends on how optimistic are you about the laser technology. If we cannot produce wall plug efficiency and average power, our technology will ultimately hit a limit. So that's absolutely central. But I think just having either these fiber-powered systems at the 5 MeV, if we can produce 5 MeV electron beams from a device that's really portable, a few millijoule laser is nothing. I think it will be game-changing for the community. If we can produce FELs that fit inside a room like this, it'll be game-changing. The same with cargo scanning. So there will be other applications that we need to aim at, and then hope that the laser guys come up with technology. There's, of course, challenges also in the plasma technology. We have done kilohertz repetition rate capillary discharges. But when you start putting 300 kilowatt through a plasma, that plasma will not remain cold. And thermal management and all the questions related to that are still open questions. And so Carl worked on part of that to park another laser pulse behind the drive laser pulse to sweep out the energy of the wake, the coherent energy of the wake, so that the energy can leave at the speed of light instead of that wake energy, which you've only used maybe 30-40% of, you're still left with 60% of wake energy. And at the energies that we're talking about, that would blow up your capillary discharges ultimately. So you have to think about optical techniques to drain the wake energy and to do photon acceleration, and that works. And then we're talking about wall plug efficiency, doing photovoltaic cells to reabsorb whatever laser pulse energy that didn't get used, recycle it. So there's a lot of opportunities for creative thinking. Spencer. Yeah, to be frank, everybody is staying away from cost right now because we honestly don't know. But at the same time, you just think about how the diode market has evolved. The diodes that you buy today are a fraction of the cost that they were 10 years ago. So it all becomes essentially, if there's enough consumers, your prices will go down. So using technology that's commodity technology, like our fiber stuff, is a wise decision because it will be used for other applications. Jim Segrist always told me, and Dennis Kovar, director of high energy physics before Segrist, always said, you better find industry that's interested in your technology because otherwise I don't have deep enough pockets to fund it. So let me give you an example of another industry that now would like these multi-kilowatt lasers, the machining industry. For years, they said, we are fine with our CW systems for machining until the field started to advance and show the advantages of not having the thermal loading of the substrates. So that's one. The second thing is, I don't know if you're familiar with what was done at the University of Rochester in terms of hydrophobic and hydrophilic tailoring of surfaces. Think lotus leaf on a plant. If you look at a lotus leaf and you drop a droplet, we all know it's going to bounce off because of the geometry of that leaf. So researchers at the University of Rochester used lasers to tailor surfaces. And just Google hydrophobic surface, University of Rochester, you'll see amazing things. They were done on coupons about an inch squared. So I've been talking to them, and they said, we would love a K-Bella laser because we can scale it up to size, and we can start talking to the Boeing companies of the world of making the plane wings hydrophobic so that you don't have to de-ice your plane anymore. So that's industrial strength customers for lasers that we can do our research with. And that's the path that we are pursuing. So we're closely following what industry is doing, and we're engaging industry in this story that we're on. Because without industry, this ain't gonna happen. I could power the collider. we don't, obviously our systems are not geared for fusion. You need much longer, much more energetic laser pulses. So it's not physics that we directly do. Some of the physics, the particle acceleration is useful. Think fast ignition schemes where you do compression of targets with fusion lasers and then you inject a particle beam that penetrates through the target to heat the core of the pellet. So there's relevant physics, obviously. All of the relativistic self-focusing, all of the particle beam generation, et cetera, that's relevant to the fusion community. Our lasers are, the NIF laser runs at megajoule. We're running at few joule.
It was really good.